Welcome to Holistic Health with Reggie. We have three wonderful guests. Stay tuned. You will be amazed.
Holistic Health.
Welcome to Holistic Health with Reggie. I'm Reggie Pittman, your host, and we have three wonderful guests. We have Dr. Antoinette Bush, we have Dr. Laurel Daniels Abuzizi, and we also have Dr. Dolores Connors. Now, they're very healthy. I was sitting in Brooklyn, and I was at a place, and the way this came out, I was at a place, I was performing. Some people know me to do some music. And what happened was, I was looking at all these healthy people. The guy was a vegan, a chef. So this is how this first came about. So you're the first guest that we have, so I'm really excited about this. How do you become so healthy? What happened? Like, were you raised on like some healthy farm, or did you like, you know, were you like just on a place where all you ate pigs and you decided you didn't want to eat pig anymore? So how did you become so healthy, anyone?
Well, I have to admit, I have to give credence to my father. My father, I had seen my father make that transition from smoking from the time I was, I say, 5 until I was 12. And I saw him make that conscious decision that he was going to stop. And then he started really working out to the point in terms of lifting weights. I started lifting weights when I was in 9th grade because that's what I'd seen him doing. So I was on my way. And he wouldn't allow me to drink sodas, wouldn't bring any sodas. Wow. into the house, and so I think I was really on my way. So by then, I wanted to ride a unicycle, and only reason I got a unicycle, my mother said, why can't you ask for a bicycle like every other normal kid on the block? And actually, when I had seen the Harlem Globetrotters, but it was my father who said, you know what, you can get it, because he wanted one when he was young. And so, I mean, again, it was just all of that kind of transition, and then from running track, that also, you know, led to a more conscious, you know, way of life. And then getting into veterinary medicine, you know, that was it. And I guess the type of practice that I enjoy doing just segue. And I'm still growing. I'm still growing in it. I can't say that I'm there. I'm still growing, I'm still tweaking. And it's exciting. So that's why you got to keep on living.
So health is a progressive thing.
Yeah,
you never really get to where you want to go.
Yeah, it's just dynamic. You need to enjoy the progress and the transitions.
So you're a veterinarian, an educator, and also an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
And you started when you were like a teenager.
Yeah, what, in terms of the veterinary medicine?
Well, I mean, as far as health, as far as weight, working out.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, when you're a teenager. Yeah. Wow, I wish I'd have started that young. No, that's not when I started. I started much. Get away from that sausage and stuff from my mom made. What? That took about 30 years. What? Oh, man. So, Dr. Abuzizi, how'd you get into health? Because I see you're reading, you work at Columbia University. And also, you're a physical therapist, and you're a professor.
Yes.
Yes. All right. So, and how did you become
I did not grow up on a healthy farm. Health farm. In fact, I would admit that we had quite a few very unhealthy practices in my house. We watched a lot of TV, ate a lot of junk food, and went to buy candy on a regular basis. But one thing, both my brother and I were very active in sports, and then I became active in dance. And I was a dancer, and as a dancer, you're a lot more conscientious about what you need to fuel your body, keeping your body strong, flexible. You need good cardiovascular fitness. So that just became a way of life in terms of physical health as a young teenager. But really, when I got injured as a dancer and turned my focus to injury prevention and then physical therapy, I started thinking more about wellness and prevention and, you know, thinking about, you know, on a grander scale about what it takes to be healthy for an entire lifetime so that you can keep using your body for everything, not necessarily to be a performer, but.
What type of dance did you do?
I did it all.
Oh, you did it all?
I went to a school that had a very strong ballet program.
High school?
At my high school. My daughter goes there now. But then I actually took time off. I was on merit scholarship at Alvin Ailey's dancing for a couple years before going to college.
So, as far you talked about dancing and an injury, because people don't really think about dance as a sport, and dancing is really, to me, it's like a basketball. Like you're constantly pounding on your legs. So I'm assuming that, you know, that had something to do with it. And sometimes some of the best things happen. I say my prostate cancer was one of the best things that happened to me because it forced me to change. So was that something that you think of that actually a negative that turned into a positive?
Absolutely. I don't think I paid any attention to things that might put me at risk for injuries until I got injured. And when it was doing a dance move, I sprained my ankle. People sprain their ankles all the time. But it was a physical therapist who actually explained the healing process, taught me about the anatomy and my muscles, and worked with me to get better. And then, absolutely, it changed my life. It changed my career focus. So
that's how you went to physical therapy?
Absolutely.
Wow. So, Dolores Connors, I have you down here. You're a reading specialist, an author, and dyslexia therapist. So how did you get into health, holistic health?
Okay, so holistic health for me means two things, physical and mental. And there are three negotiables that I have in life at this point, and I pray, run, and read every single day. Those things just have to happen. I can run in place for 5 minutes, or I can run for half an hour, but it's something that I have to do. I have to read something inspirational just to center myself, just to bring myself to a different kind of reflection. And then I also have to pray, because it's my spiritual faith that keeps me grounded. So those things are extremely important to me, and I believe that those things keep me healthy. Regardless of what's happening with my body, those things really stand out.
Well, it's you mentioned something that I wanted to talk about, which is you talked about physical and mental health. And people really think of health as far as your body and how you treat your body, what you put in, which is nutrition is definitely important. I think we all agree on that. Mm-hmm. But mental health, you know, I break things down into five groups. Physical, like mm-hmm. mental, spiritual, economics, and spiritual, right? Did I say spiritual already?
Mm-hmm.
All right, so emotional, that's the one I left out. Sorry about that. So as far as mental health and as far as related to stress, like how important is that to your overall health, stress?
I'd like to answer that.
Oh yeah, please.
Stress will kill you, but stress is inevitable.
Can you be a little more clear?
No, I mean, there are hormones that are released that do bad things to our bodies when we experience a lot of stress and aren't able to cope with it effectively. But it's inevitable. Even good things can cause stress in our lives, but finding healthy ways to manage stress is really key to health. I think that mind-body balance is really important. Finding, whether it's taking a hot bath, whether it's doing meditation, I practice yoga, I practice Tai Chi, I practice daily gratitude. I think keeping a gratitude diary, being an optimist, things that you can do to really mentally focus on your well-being can help keep stress in check. And stress is good for fight or flight when we're in danger.
Oh,
and
it's needed.
You know,
right.
Need to kick into high gear,
yes.
But otherwise it will raise your blood sugar, will cause a lot of problems. So.
Right. How do you two deal with stress? So you do yoga and Tai Chi. Mm-hmm. I do yoga too. It's a myth that males don't like to do yoga and meditation. We're going to talk about that a little later, hopefully. But what do you two do to deal with stress, to reduce stress?
Well, I mean, I think everybody has I just love the fact I'm in your presence because there's such a tie with having that kind of alone time, which is always a challenge. And the prayer piece, you know, as far as, again, to piggyback off, is just been so crucial. You know, for me to just have that moment to let it all out, mm-hmm. and to just sit quietly so that things can come in, and when I don't do that, when I stay up too late and don't get that time, my whole day is so different. Mm. The whole day is different. If I don't get that time to center, it's the transition is just so different. So it's key. It's key. And it's still, for me, it's still a fight. But it's a good fight because I see the benefits.
But Doc, you don't sleep that much. I mean, I'm listening to you. I'm listening to you. I'm listening to you. That's a really nice thing.
I'm
listening to you. I'm like, see, you work more than anybody I know. She's sitting there talking about sleep. Now, I know I don't sleep that much. If I get 6 hours, that's good, you know. But my body will let me know when I need more. So when my body says, you're about to go to sleep, I go to sleep, you know. So I try to listen to my body for everything. Everybody has issues as far as what they need to do, whether it's food, you know, whether it's gambling, whether it's alcohol, you know, whatever it is, everybody has issues. One of mine, I'm not going to mention too many.